Very good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Jeremy Balfour. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So our next item is the first evidence session of the committee's short inquiry into how effective the Scottish Child Payment is in reducing child poverty. Today we'll hear from academics from a number of different universities, as well as from a representative from the Institute for Fiscal Studies. So I welcome to the meeting Ruth Patrick, Professor in Social Policy, and Emma Tominey, Professor in Economics, both from the University of York. So thank you very much for attending. Thank you. And we are joined online by Danny Dorling, Halford Mackinder, Professor of Geography, University of Oxford, Tom Wernham, Research Economist, Institute for Fiscal Studies, and Dr. Juliet Stone, Research Fellow, Centre for Research in Social Policy, Loughborough University. Thank you all for accepting our invitation. And just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So if you could please wait until I or a member asking the question, say your name before speaking. And don't feel you have to answer every single question. If you have nothing new to add to what's been said by others, then that's okay. For witnesses online, if you could please allow our broadcasting colleagues a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you start to speak. And you can indicate with an R in the chat box in Zoom if you wish to come in on a question. And can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So we'll now move on to the questions, and the first theme is about the impact on poverty. And I'm going to direct this to Danny Dorling in the first hand, and if anybody else wishes to come in, then please do so. So Danny, what do we know so far about the effectiveness of the Scottish Child Payment in lifting children out of poverty?
We're still waiting for definitive answers, because they will depend on surveys, official surveys, such as the Family Resource Survey, which is used to produce the households below average income data set. And that data set is released every March for the financial year, which ended the March before. So it will become very clear around springtime next year. But already we know that the uptake of the extra benefits is pretty high. We know it is incredibly well targeted, and it is very easy to produce a very simple model where you look at the distribution of families with children in Scotland, the incomes that they have as recorded from those surveys for previous years, you apply the uplift, and you work out what the effect should be. And because the money is targeted so well, and because it is not tapered in that families do not lose out from other benefits because they receive this, then in terms of taking children over various poverty thresholds, the effects should be very great indeed.
Okay, thank you very much. Would anyone else like to come in? Ruth Patrick, thanks.
Yeah, thanks so much. So I think just kind of echoing Danny in terms of, you know, still waiting for the quantitative evidence base, but just to kind of really encourage the committee and, you know, all of us really to recognise that there's also a qualitative evidence base that we can look at. So actually we can talk directly and, you know, to parents and carers in Scotland and ask them, you know, what impact is that having? What difference is it making? How are you living? How is this extra money, like, changing how you kind of make decisions about what you can and can't do for you and your family? And that can happen in real time. So I'd really encourage that kind of level of inquiry as well, because that will give us, whereas a kind of statistical data set, there is an inevitable time lag, but with actually speaking directly to parents, we can be doing that right now and finding out the impact it is having.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you very much. Julia, I believe you would like to come in.
Thank you. Yes, just to follow up on what Danny has said about the quantitative sort of monitoring of the effect of the Scottish Child Payment, I think we probably need to find alternative ways of doing that, because the Family Resources Survey, there are some issues with the data, which I think the members may be aware of. That they have a very large undercount of universal credit claimants in the FRS, and that isn't just explained by people underreporting having universal credit. And obviously, because that is linked to eligibility for the Scottish Child Payment, that is going to affect how we monitor that. And I would just argue for looking for alternative ways of monitoring, for example, through the Children in Low-Income Families data, which I've had some conversations with the Department for Work and Pensions about, which is currently calibrated to the households below average income data. So sort of takes on those same issues, but they are looking at doing that in a slightly different way. So, just to flag up that there may be other better ways of monitoring the success of the policy.
Okay. You've kind of come on to my next question in terms of, you know, to the extent in terms of the limitations of, you know, the poverty statistics and the sort of limitations in that as well. And the impact it's had. So how do you think that might be resolved? And I'll carry on with yourself, Juliet.
So I think, as well as the data set that I mentioned, the Children in Low-Income Families data, which hopefully going forward will provide a more robust way of monitoring child poverty. I think just sort of... I guess arguing for the DWP to really focus on trying to improve these statistics, because there are particular issues with the regional estimates as well, which obviously for Scotland is a big issue. So trying to improve the representativeness of those data, I think, is really key. But as well, linking administrative data, I think, is going to be really important going forward. So obviously the HMRC and the DWP already do link some of their records, but there could be more done on that, I think, as well.
Okay, thank you. I believe Tom Wernham would like to come in.
Yeah, I just wanted to sort of echo the concerns of the limitations of the official poverty statistics from the Family Resources Survey. I think the plans that are in place to link that survey to administrative data in future years might to some extent mitigate that. It's going to deal with the sort of underreporting element, because we'll be able to observe universal credit claimants. I don't actually know if there are plans for DWP to receive data from Scotland on whether the Scottish Child Payment in particular has been applied for, but that's something that sounds very important to make sure does happen. In terms of representativeness, these plans aren't going to help per se. They're going to look at weighting the survey better once they've linked administrative data, which might help. But yeah, I would add that it's going to be valuable to have better regional information. Bringing in more data sets will be useful. I also just wanted to sort of make another sort of conceptual point, not just focusing on the binary measure, are people in poverty or not, with the child payment. The Scottish Child Payment is going to have significantly increased incomes of people who are well below the poverty line, and even if it doesn't bring them right past the poverty line, alleviating depth of poverty, that's still going to be an achievement of the payment, which needs to be taken into consideration. And yeah, I think a sort of fuller look at the impact across the income distribution can sometimes be more valuable than just looking at, you know, is somebody in poverty or not? Because that's, at the end of the day, the poverty is a useful summary measure and it's just useful to have these targets, but it is the poverty line is drawn fairly arbitrarily. So I think it's useful to have a fuller picture of how much income people have and how that's changing as a result of the payment.
Okay, thanks very much, Tom. I believe Danny Dorling would like to come back in.
Yes, I agree with everything everybody has said. I'll just add two things. Firstly, on the arbitrariness of the poverty line, when a very large number of children were tipped over that line at the start of this century and things were said to improve, the tipping was such a small thing that we didn't, for instance, see the physical condition of children improve. They began to become stunted and grow shorter as supposedly they came out of poverty, because people were not looking at the overall distribution. They were just concerned about that one line. And that looks increasingly like a grave error, because it's around about the year 2005 that the stunting of children across the UK began to increase. And if you want a really graphic reason about why you don't just concentrate about the poverty line, if you don't want your children to physically be becoming shorter, you need to think a bit more widely than the poverty line. On the problems with the FRS, the Department of Work and Pensions did reduce their funding for the survey and so made it worse deliberately by government. That needs to be said. Furthermore, and less their fault, the pandemic, of course, made it difficult to collect the data. And so often we're going back to 2018, 2019 to make comparisons. But the last thing I want to say on this is you have to be careful that improving the quality of these surveys, which hopefully will happen in the future, doesn't mean you think things have got worse because you're including people in the surveys who were not included before. What you have to do is worry not so much about the biases in the survey, but whether the biases are changing. Because if the surveys exclude the same proportions of people over time, but show an improvement, then there may well really have been an improvement, even though the quality of the survey wasn't good. None of this is too difficult to be done, as long as those in charge of it being done and in charge of the secure data genuinely want to know what has really happened. In the country in Europe with the biggest rise, according to UNICEF, of child poverty on the continent. So this should be our absolute, sorry, by country, I mean UK. This should be our absolute priority from the point of view of social scientists. The differences of what's occurring in Scotland to the rest of the UK are a stunning social experiment. I shouldn't refer to that because it's people's lives and it's terrible. But the attention of social scientists from across Europe should be looking at the UK. What is happening? What can policy do? What has it done? Not least because UNICEF, in the Innocente report in December at the end of last year, just showed how much the UK stands out as a sore thumb of not only having high child poverty and deprivation, but the biggest increase of every country that they surveyed around the world.
Okay, thank you. That is really, really interesting, Danny. I believe Emma Tomney would like to come in.
Yeah, so I just wanted to add a little bit more of a push for this link to administrative data. So what we see in Scandinavian countries, if they want to measure the impact of policies, if they want to measure poverty, is they have this link to administrative data. And it feels in Scotland like their infrastructure's there, because a lot of administrative data have been linked, but just not that final link to the social security data. So For example, what you would be able to look at is you could look at the same the population of Scotland, but you would see the same families across time, and you would see Scottish Child Payment coming in, and you could see the impact that makes in their household. And that's a huge contrast, for example, to the Family Resource Survey, where it's a cross-section, different set of households. So, you know, whether it's to understand the proportion of children living in poverty, or whether it's to dig deeper and understand the consequences for labour supply, for education, it's the linked administrative data that's going to really allow us to explore in depth the effect of Scottish Child Payment.
Okay, thank you very much. Before I move on to the next theme, I wanted to touch upon, and I don't know if any of the other members want to come in on this, but I don't know if you are aware about the recent modelling that was carried out. It was funded by the Trussell Trust in terms of food parcels and the impact of the Scottish Child Payment in comparison to the uptake on food parcels. And there has been some significant reduction in terms of ages and whatnot as well, which is a good thing. And while we're touching on data as well, I don't know if anybody wants to actually comment on that and any other further modelling that could be done to see the impact and ultimately reduce the uptake on food parcels. Ruth.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I could come in just to say that it's good to see. It's not surprising. Like, I think, you know, as we sort of touched on already, this is like a really significant investment in children and in the lives of families with children. So the fact that that would then have a kind of consequence on food bank use is not surprising. I think in terms of that kind of second part of your question about what more do we need to do? What more data do we need to generate? You know, myself and Emma and colleagues at London School of Economics in the University of York, we're desperate and very much hoping to get some research off the ground that looks at the impact of the Scottish Child Payment in comparative perspectives. So following on from what Danny said, you know, it is a very rare opportunity within kind of social security policy, within social policy, to actually say what difference is this making? You know, so we look at the lives and the experiences of families with children in England who aren't receiving it and the experiences of families in Scotland who are, you know, how is that making a difference? I think that's important for like loads of reasons. Like, I really, really want to do the work. But I think it's especially important because the policy has rolled out against a very difficult and particular socioeconomic context. So if we try and understand what the impact the policy is having, we obviously all are, you know, completely aware of the cost of living crisis. We're aware of UK policy decisions such as the two-child limit. They're interacting with the policy in presumably very interesting and difficult ways. And so if we're to understand, well, what difference is the policy actually making, we need to start to kind of dig deeper. And I think doing it into the comparative perspective will be really helpful. So,
okay, thank you, Ruth. That's really good. Danny would like to come back in.
Yes, just, and I have no vested interest in this at all, but I think it's just worth getting on the record that the key potential funders for this research work, which I would not be involved in, are the Economic and Social Research Council, the Nuffield Trust, the Wellcome Trust, possibly the Roundtree Foundation. If they do not think about this now and step forward now, it'll be too late to do the studies, which are not just in the direct interests of families and young people in the UK, but also could help tell people worldwide what can be done for a relatively small amount of money with a potentially very large impact. And it is those bodies deciding their research priorities, particularly, say, Wellcome over children. We have rising child mortality now in the UK, who really do need to think that in the next 12 months, 24 months, if they have not decided to fund very serious studies that deal with the complexities and help show the answers, so we will lose, in terms of social science, the ability to monitor the effect of this for wider interest in Europe and around the world. Because of the terrible situation the UK has come in, it actually allows you to see what can you do. And there are other parts of Europe which are almost as poor as the UK, and many parts of the world which are. So there was a wider reason for wanting to do this work, and it doesn't have, of course, to be just quantitative. It would just be such a shame for it not to be done now, and for us years later to say, oh, we look back and something dramatic happened then, and we can look at the records of children's heights and, oh, look, they began to grow taller again in Scotland, which would be lovely. But it's frustrating to me that the major funders of research, as far as I know, have not stepped forward as far as they could do to look at this. We're in a period of purdah, so they can't say anything at the moment, but they could be thinking about it and they could act very, very quickly after the general election.
Okay, thank you, Danny. I believe that Julie, I think Katie wants to come in with a supplementary, and then I'm going to invite Julia in. Thanks.
It was really just to pick up on something that Danny asked, and it may be that he could write to us if it's going to be a very lengthy answer. But he referred to 2005 and the stunting of children's growth there, and it would be helpful to have a better understanding of that, given that that was a time when tax credits were being brought in and there was a lot of money being targeted to some of the poorest families, to working families in particular. And, you know, there were very significant reductions in child poverty. So it would be helpful to have a better understanding of the point that you were making, Danny, if that was possible.
I'd be very happy to write. The key thing is it only just began around 2005. It was obvious by 2010 that across the UK, unlike in the rest of Europe, children were not growing. And the government, around about 2005 to 2010, did a lot of saying how great their success was on child poverty, but they were concentrating on this one, tipping children from just below to just over a line, which children, you know, their families would hardly feel the effects of that. And sadly, we saw the truth of this in the heights of children, the decline beginning then. It's got much worse since. It's a kind of political headline figure of, look, we've done this. It's unfair to China, but it was always called the kind of Chinese technique of saying you've moved so many people just over a line, haven't you done well? What really matters is taking families in deep poverty out of the deep poverty. Now, they'll still be poor, but their situation will be much better. That wasn't included in the target for the new Labour government at the time. And families who are just above the poverty line, improving their lives, and they do better as well. That wasn't in the new Labour target. And in hindsight, we have not examined that period and seen in what ways it failed, not least, that the economic inequality between families did not alter one iota in the years 1997 to 2010. And that really matters, because if you don't improve things, then later on it is much easier for governments which come in afterwards to cause greater damage. The UK child poverty story is utterly appalling in comparison to every other country in Europe. And it is partly to blame for all political parties and policies, when we have to step back and say, this really is a monumental failure. When you look at the Innocente report of December of last year, we do need to step back and say, so many years and so many different regimes were in charge that although they differed and some people's hearts were more in the right place than others, the overall effect on our children, and this will be for the rest of their lives, was terrible, and that was a failure. And so tinkering around and slight point scoring political parties is not going to be enough. We should learn this from what has happened to date, rather than say the record was so great at a time when we know that the physical effects on children of the situation they were being in has resulted, unlike in other countries in Europe, the stunting of our children at the time when we were celebrating supposedly taking them out of poverty. The United States, by the way, had a similar occurrence. we were behaving more and more like the United States and not like other countries in mainland Europe.
Okay, thank you very much, Danny. I believe Juliet wants to come in.
Yeah, thank you. Just really briefly, just to echo what some of the other contributors have said about how we're monitoring the sort of effects of the child payment and sort of child wellbeing in more general. I think, you know, obviously it would be called a child poverty strategy, but I think just focusing on that, as we say, that arbitrary line isn't really enough. I think we do need to definitely take that more holistic approach and look at things like educational outcomes, look at things like health outcomes for children, because actually I think otherwise we're looking, it's a very narrow view of what effects the Scottish Child Payment could have. So yeah, that, I'll leave it there because I just wanted to really echo what other people have said.
Okay, thank you very much. Now I'm going to move on to the next theme, which is monitoring and valuation, and I'm going to invite Paul Keenan. Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. And I suppose perhaps following on from the themes in the first section there, I'm interested in terms of how we monitor and evaluate, and I think we've covered quite a lot of that already. But I would be particularly interested if the panel had views on the Scottish Government's own modelling in terms of the child payment and the impact that it has. So the Scottish Government obviously use a model that looks at a counterfactual scenario where certain policies don't exist, and then looks at the comparison, and I think from that they draw that the child payment would have an impact of, I think, keeping 60,000 children out of poverty. I think 100,000 children is mentioned as well, but there is a kind of interchangeability, if you like, between keeping children out of poverty and lifting them out of poverty. So I think it would be useful, given the context of what we just said about the need for more quantitative data and perhaps more time to elapse so we can better understand it, just to get your view of the modelling that the Scottish Government itself is using on and the figures that they're arriving at.
As Ruth said, I think the comparative is really important because, you know, I guess we need to think what you're trying to aim at achieving with a Scottish child payment. And during a cost of living crisis, if you just look at families within Scotland, for example, it could be that the Scottish child payment enabled households to cope with the rising costs, the rising living costs. And so, you know, whereas in England, in the other nations of the UK, it could be that those families were less able to cope with the rising costs. So then I think it's very important to, you know, make that comparison, because ultimately what I think, without the comparison, we underestimate the effect of Scottish child payment. It might look like there's not that much effect, not much is going on in Scottish households, when actually you're really helping households from staying out of poverty. And then in terms of monitoring, I mean, looking at international evidence about the effects of cash transfers for families on low income, they have profound effects on a range of outcomes, like Juliet was saying, not just on poverty. But, you know, you can see studies where children, when they were growing up in the household and there was cash transferred received in the US, for example, through the earned income tax credit, when they become adults, those children then earn more money as adults. There's a change in social mobility. So, you know, I'd emphasise again not to really just focus just on a poverty statistic, but try to understand firstly what's going on in the short run. And in the short run, what do we expect to happen? We expect maybe financial situation slowly improves and things slowly ease. And across time, the households can use the money and you might see a benefit for children. But the real impact is going to last into adulthood for those children as well. So we've read the interim reports from the Scottish Government, and that there's a lot going on there, and it's really interesting. But we also think it's important to have independent and academically rigorous evidence to complement that. And I'm sure a lot of economists and social sciences across the UK are going to be keen to analyse this. So the way that we can do that is looking at these surveys. Just to highlight the problem, in the Family Resource Survey in the 2 waves ago, there were 200 households who were potentially eligible for a Scottish child payment. So it's a really small number, a really small sample. If we, you know, what we need is an improvement in the data across time, and not to repeat myself, but this linked administrative data, the data sets exist, they're there. We can analyse it to really understand the full consequence, the full benefit of the Scottish Child Payment.
Paul, sorry, you wanted to come back in there.
No. I don't know if anyone else wanted to comment on the Scottish Government's model more broadly.
Danny would like to come in. Sorry.
I've been looking at it. I think it's very rigorous and very fair and good quality work. It tends to be careful. And one thing just to think about is there may well be researchers from other countries in Europe who will be wanting to look at this because it is such an outlier. Often when you're studying the place you live, you tend to emphasise the complexities of what's going on. And often if you live in a place, you don't tend to notice or you find it hard to talk about successes as much. So those, I think it was mentioned earlier, the Scandinavian Nordic countries, which have such good data, if you and such good results, some of the lowest rates of child poverty and deprivation on the planet, if you look at the research that's done within Nordic countries, it's often talking about the problems there. Because, of course, if you want to make things better, you have to concentrate on the problems. I do suspect that if we were open to researchers from other countries being allowed to look at some of our records, not just ourselves, it would be interesting to see what they would find and say from a view which was dispassionate in another way. I was recently at a conference in Paris of people who study England, and the shocking thing was hearing the place I live discussed as a kind of experiment in a way without the emotions. And it was quite chilling in one way, but quite instructive to be told this is what's happening and hear it from the point of view of somebody who's just interested much more in the facts and not in the politics. So there is so much to be done, but don't think it'll all just be done by people in the UK or in Scotland. The UK is such an outlier now internationally. Scotland is doing such interesting and different things that there will be people from outside who will want to look at this. And it's not just that we need to compare with England and whether this payment has meant that people are able to at least to stand still rather than sink as they've done in England. We also need to compare with families right around the periphery of Europe, because the UK is now a peripheral European country in terms of its economy, in terms of its levels of child poverty, in terms of infant mortality. Those are the comparisons to be made, but it's possible that part of the UK may have one of the best records in the periphery of Europe in terms of policy, and that matters for people around the continent of Europe.
I wonder if, and just reflecting on Professor Dorland's contribution to Katie Clark, in terms of the modelling that looks at a counterfactual scenario and then looks at how many children are kept out of poverty and the point that you made about the poverty line and the temptation, I suppose, for governments of all colours just to engage in, we've kept children from that line. I mean, would your view there's a temptation for that to happen in this context as well? Oh, I think we've lost your sound. We lost your sound there, so I don't know if you're able to...
Okay, I'm back. It's complicated. It's not just about being kept out and that being such an advantage. If a state does well, Finland is a great example, then you encourage people in, which has occurred in Finland. So the second city is celebrating a population now of over 200,000 and growing. You encourage people in whose children do well. You also don't lose families who are poor, who leave in desperation. So migration matters. Who decides to come? How well do they do? Who doesn't decide to leave? Do your cities manage to do well rather than suffer huge population losses, which if you go back to the 70s and 80s in Scotland, they were on a great scale internationally. So there's counterfactual after counterfactual to do with migration. Who decides they can have a child? You know, if people are so poor that they decide they can't have a child, then you don't have a child born into poverty. But that isn't necessarily a success. I'm sorry to do the standard social science thing of saying it's a bit complicated, because it's not that complicated. You know, we can understand the situation of people feeling they're too poor to have children. Teachers in the city I live in Oxford cannot afford to have children themselves, you know, and that really matters. And it won't show up in a poverty statistic, but you have to think about these issues as well. What you're trying to get, in my view, is a society where people can have children, where those children are not suffering terribly. These kind of societies exist across this continent. There are 15 countries now which are as equal as the five Nordic countries in terms of income inequality, including France and Germany. So, you know, we can look at what is possible, but it has wider effects than just the counterfactuals. Just the last example I'll give you about the success of Germany. Germany now includes a large number of children who were born abroad who were war refugees. For a few years, the average height of children in Germany fell ever so slightly as those war refugees were allowed in. Now it is rising. The UK looks like a country which accepted huge numbers of war refugees, but we didn't. But we looked like that from what has happened to the heights of our children. So there are many things you need to consider with counterfactuals, and one of which is out-migration and in-migration. Who decides to live in our cities or leave our cities, and who is able to have children and the circumstances that they can have them in when they choose to have children.
Thank you very much. I believe Ruth would like to come in and then Tom. And if you could make it as brief as possible, because I'm conscious at the time and we've still got quite a lot of questions to get through as well. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So just, I guess, I'll try and be super brief. But I think that obviously it's complex. It's like it's a difficult picture. Like, yeah, we don't want to like fixate on the poverty line, but also it's still valuable. So I just don't, and I'm sure, you know, it's still valuable to kind of keep track of that. And I think it's important to recognise that, you know, the Scottish government's the only government within the UK that has those kind of policy poverty targets that's kind of working in that way. So I would just kind of maybe caution a little bit, like throwing out the baby with the bathwater, that yes, you know, things are happening alongside it, but kind of keeping an eye on what's happening with poverty is important. And I think if we look, I work with Kitty Stewart and some colleagues looking at kind of what happened to poverty rates across kind of the New Labour period and then post 2010, and kind of almost all the changes in terms of the poverty rates were driven by changes in social security. So, you know, social security is an important lever here. And I think what's also really important, and it does kind of follow on to something that Danny said, is around the changes that are happening around child poverty are particularly around larger families. So we're talking an awful lot about what happens and what different social security transfers do and don't make for families with three or more children. And that really matters. So if we think about the Scottish Child Payment, it's again a reason why this is really, really well targeted policy, because it's saying, let's look at families' needs. Let's look at what needs that family has. And we know that, and like I know as a mother of four children, that if you've got four children in the house, they have a lot of needs, okay? And what we've seen, especially at the UK government level, is we've seen this divorcing of the relationship between need and entitlement. And what the Scottish Child Payment does is it is a way of correcting that. And it's saying, we know absolutely that when there's a child in this household, that child has needs, and we're going to help you meet those needs. And I think that's important, both materially, but also symbolically, because what you're saying there is you're saying that these children matter, they count, and we want to do something about them. And so I think that's a really welcome and vital element of the policy.
Okay, thanks very much, Ruth. I'm going to invite Tom in now.
I'll be really quick. I will absolutely reinforce everything everyone said about importance of administrative data, making these comparisons and the complexities of it's not just straightforward looking at incomes as other effects. But I wanted to highlight just a couple of sort of easy improvements that could be made to just sort of how the modelling is presented. With the talk we've had about poverty being an arbitrary line and things, I think it'd be better if the Scottish government sort of published how incomes are changing across the distribution, this many pounds for the poorest 10%, next 10%, and so on, just to get a fuller picture, sort of things we put out at IFS before. I think it helps to not just get fixated on this binary measure. It's very easy to do. Also, even in the survey data, not relying on, new data, there are other outcomes you can look at, not just income. There's measures of, are families keeping up with their bills? Are they feeling like they're suffering food insecurity? Just things like that in the data that we already have. And I think it'd be valuable to see if we can observe trends in those things changing over time for families with children as well. And in particular, are there families who aren't being captured by the Scottish Child Payment, where there are still children living in households, suffering deprivation along other measures. So I think, there's some easy wins that could be made in terms of just making fuller use of the data that's already going into the modelling.
Okay, that's really useful. Thanks very much, Tom. I believe Bob would like to come in on a supplementary, and then I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thanks.
Just really briefly, I should say, first of all, I thought Professor Patrick gave a very eloquent narrative around the two-child cap without actually mentioning it, more eloquent than any politician probably has done, so thank you for putting that on the record. It was the relationship between, I think, targets and monitoring and the Scottish Government modelling work that Mr Keane was talking about. I think it was roughly 26% down to 19% in poverty levels falling in Scotland. But the discourse around that was about, well, your target was 18%, and the benefit of the progress made seemed to dissipate and be lost in that real lived experience. So Professor Patrick was talking about that monitoring and evaluation between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So I represent Maryhill, what's happening in Merseyside, what are the factors that's making a difference there. So if Professor Patrick could say a little bit more about how we could do that would be quite helpful. But Professor Dorling, I think, was talking about this could be so significant. What we really want to look at is on a European basis. So it's not, I hate alliteration, but Maryhill, Merseyside, what's happening in Marseille with child poverty, what are European nations doing, and how can we learn from each other? So for Professor Dorling, who would commission that? Because if the Scottish Government commissions it, they could be accused of being impartial in that process. And what we want is robust, academic, independent-led study. If this is something so significant, it could have public policy benefit, not just for the UK, but beyond. So I hope that's brief enough, sorry. Professor Patrick.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks so much. So, I mean, it's really hard to be brief in response because there's lots that could be said. So I think firstly, in terms of that target and the kind of response to kind of missing the target, it does reflect back to kind of a conversation we've already had in the session about people where they live pushing for more, pushing for better. So I think that's a good push. Like, yeah. I mean, I think it's the right push. Like, I think it's a really positive thing to be kind of talking within Scotland about an ambition to kind of eradicate child poverty, to put children at the centre of a kind of policy agenda feels really positive. So I guess I would encourage not to be disheartened by that push. I know that within the kind of anti-poverty sector in Scotland, there's calls to increase the Scottish Child Payment. I think they're good calls, they're sound calls. I think in terms of the, like, what do we do? Like, how do we understand it? There's, again, like, hard to be brief, but I'll try. So if we're trying to look at, and, it's worth saying I'm not a statistician. I don't really understand. Well, I do understand statistics. But, like, my evidence base is qualitative, so it's about speaking directly to parents and carers. And I think, and you know what we're proposing to do, and it's worth saying we do have a funding application under consideration at the moment. So, hopefully we'll have good news before too long. But what we'd like to do is talk directly to parents and carers within Scotland and also within England. And actually, within that, it's about trying to understand, what's going on in the surface, what are people's day-to-day lives like, what difference is the money making, what difference is it not making, and also the intersect with different policies as well. I think one of the things, if we think about your kind of constituents in Maryhill, it's about recognising that really kind of difficult interplay between policies and decisions that are made at the UK level with policies and decisions that are made at the Scottish Government. So one of my recent pieces of work was looking at the impact of the benefit cap and two-child limit on families with three or more children. And, obviously and unfortunately, there are people in Scotland that are being affected. Now you're mitigating the benefit cap, but they're being affected by the two-child limit. And, the interplay of those policies means that in some cases, the support that's provided by the Scottish Child Payment is just kind of helping cover the losses that are covered by the two-child limit. So I think that's it's a really kind of unfortunate state of play. But it's also worth saying that in terms of the methodology with the two-child limit and the benefit cap work, what we were doing is we were doing something called qualitative longitudinal research. And that's where we follow families families over time. So we're following a kind of, you know, often quite a small number of families, but over time, returning to them, understanding, getting a dynamic picture about what's happening in those households, how a life's being lived, you know, against a policy context that's also changing. So I think that doing that's really important. And I also think, and I've sort of said this already, so I'll say it briefly, but I think just speaking directly to parents and carers. So, I mean, one of my other kind of policy agendas is around trying to say, you know, whose expertise counts. And obviously we all love, and I love being invited to speak before this committee, but, you know, there is expertise within Scotland of people receiving Scottish Child Payment. Right now, I work with people through a project called Changing Realities. You could invite them to something like this and ask them what difference it's making to their lives. And I think that that testimony and that kind of expertise that comes by experience would be really important and would help you with these policy decisions as well.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm now going to move over to John Mason. Thank you.
Thanks. Yes, well, I was going to ask about this question of targets, because I think we're at 26% of children in poverty at the moment. We're meant to be hitting 18%. 23, 24, 10% by 30, 31. Now, you're all saying that the picture's much more complicated than that, but in politics, it's that number that matters. That's the only one that matters. That's the only one the politicians talk about. So, and from that point of view, Scottish Child Payment hasn't made a huge impact, it would appear. I mean, Dr. Stone, you talked about having a narrow view, or not having a narrow view, but politicians do have a narrow view. How can we tackle that?
So I think it's difficult to see how we can change that view, because it's so ingrained. And as a, I guess as somebody who works with statistics, I'm quite comfortable with uncertainty to an extent. So, you know, that estimate, it is an estimate. That 26% is not, that's not counting the number of children in poverty. That is an estimate from survey data. So in a sense, I think however you do it, and whatever that target is, you know, there's always going to be uncertainty around it. And it's a difficult message to get across, I think, because as you say, people want that number, they want that fixed number. And it's an issue we come across all the time when, you know, trying to communicate and disseminate this kind of research, you know, that people just want that exact number. And, you know, as a researcher, I'm kind of often reluctant to give that number. But I'm not really quite sure how we change that. I guess it's thinking about possibly, if we want that number, not just relying on one source. So I think we've talked about the issues with the FRS and with the HBAI statistics. I think I'd sort of reiterate what I said before, is that let's not just rely on that. You know, OK, we want to reach this target, but let's not just base it on this one data set, which actually has some problems when there are other data sources like the linked administrative data, where we could probably get a more robust, still an estimate, but a robust estimate of what that number is.
OK, thank you. I mean, I wonder, Professor Tominey, you know, should we be setting targets at all? Would it be better if we didn't and just did good work?
It's important to set targets. It's important to have a political agenda. And, you know, that does, Scotland is distinct in that compared to the rest of the UK. So that's important. But you can't, I really don't think that you can judge the success of Scottish Child Payment by whether or not you've hit those targets, because the actual number, the proportion of children living in poverty, that's partly determined by the social security system and the environment that you can influence, and it's partly determined by factors that are just out of your control. So you've had a Russian war, we've had pandemics, cost of living crisis. So if that proportion stays the same, the Scottish Child Payment could have been very successful. If poverty, that proportion goes up, the Scottish Child Payment could have been really successful, because the counterfactual is what would have happened if you didn't have that policy. So, you know, there are political reasons why it's very, is a nice idea to have the target. But I just think, you know, for example, Tom's suggestions about looking across the income distribution, you can also produce statistics that are quite easy for public to engage in and easy for you to judge the success of the policy. but it has to be a comparable, it has to be a comparison. What would have happened if you didn't have the Scottish Child Payment? And to get that, you need some analysis. That's not going to be a simple statistic. So, you know, if you invest, if you, you know, work with the Scottish Government to work hard to produce those comparable numbers, then it still can be something that I think politicians can use and that the public can understand.
Okay, thank you. I'm okay with
I believe Danny Dorlan would like to come in. Thanks.
Oh, yes. There are ways of presenting the very basic statistic that tells you something different. I started looking at these in the late 1980s when Scotland had some of the worst statistics in the UK. That simple poverty line proportion, every region in England is now worse than Scotland. I'm talking to you from the southeast of England, which doesn't include London. This is the leafy, richest part of England. We have a higher child poverty rate than Scotland, and we don't have a target. You know, there is a point to having some targets and focus and thinking about this. There was an earlier question about who would do the work across Europe. Eurostat do include non-UK, non-EU countries in their work. And I think that'll be worthwhile. And this matters because the UK, once Germany reunified, the UK had the biggest geographical inequalities in all of Europe. There were many parts of Europe where people worry about geographical inequalities within states. We may be the state in Europe which has had the biggest change in a geographical inequality in terms of child poverty of any other. So when you're worrying about the peripheral poorer parts of Italy or Spain, Europe might actually have something to learn from what's happened in the UK because of this part of the UK. We shouldn't say to people elsewhere in Europe, we're the experts, we don't want you looking, it's all very complicated. I think we should welcome the interest that we're very likely to get of how has this happened in a place which where it appeared that Scotland would always have higher child poverty, at least in the affluent parts of England. And it's been shown already that Scotland has lower child poverty. And that is before we begin to see the impacts of this particular policy on top of what in hindsight is an incredible achievement.
Okay. Thanks very much, Danny. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for your time this morning. I'll go first to Dr. Stone. I'd like to seek your views on ways to help ensure all children in poverty are eligible for the Scottish Child Payment.
Yeah, thanks. So we know there are particular groups of children that are sort of excluded from receiving the Scottish Child Payment. I'm thinking particularly of families with no recourse to public funds, who often, you know, will be, because of the eligibility criteria for the Scottish Child Payment, are very much linked to receiving universal credit or child benefit. So these families will often not have those, will not meet that eligibility criteria. And these are some of the most vulnerable children in the country. So I think there needs to be some way of increasing the sort of range of eligibility criteria in order to capture those families. And then, of course, there are other families who are probably eligible for universal credit but are not actually even applying for it. And we know that with managed migration that actually there are the number of families who were on tax credits is much higher than the ones that have moved on to universal credit. So there are families who are not actually taking up universal credit when they're moving off tax credits. So I think there are different groups there that need to be targeted. And I know that I've had some conversations with people around the minimum income guarantee and how they're sort of trying to include those sort of hidden populations within, you know, that minimum income guarantee, and whether that's to do with providing more accesses to services, and that then that is then linked to, so if they're sort of referred to particular health services or sort of educational services, that then sort of flags them up as being eligible for the Scottish Child Payment. That could be one way forward.
Thank you. I'm interested in your written submission where you say the Scottish Child Payment is for many families simply acting to offset the consequentials of UK level policies that restrict their incomes. Most importantly, the two-child limit and the benefit cap. Fully addressing child poverty in Scotland therefore requires action at UK level as well as national level. Are you aware of many families receiving the Scottish Child Payment that are also impacted by the two-child policy and the benefit cap?
I mean, there'll be many, many families who are in that situation, yes. And I mean, echoing what Ruth said earlier, you know, I think that we know that the two-child limit has an absolutely devastating effect on the risk of children being in poverty. And yeah, that's no different in Scotland. And I think I would echo what Ruth said about the fact that the Scottish Child Payment is going some way to sort of recognising that those children count. But it's probably not going far enough. And I think, you know, for example, my colleagues at Child Poverty Action Group, you know, are calling for the Scottish Child Payment to be increased to £40. You know, I know other organisations have also called for sort of cash increases to the Scottish Child Payment. But I do think that there needs to be more kind of push to address the issues that are caused by those sort of punitive policies in Westminster. Yeah, I would definitely think that needs to be part of any sort of child poverty strategy, is to try and mitigate against those in a more profound way than giving cash transfers.
Thank you. And finally, you're aware in Scotland we're trying to mitigate the benefit cap through discretionary housing payments.
Yeah.
Have you taken an interest in this intervention and its impact alongside the Scottish Child Payment?
Yeah, so I think this is a really good policy. I think the only issue with it is that the uptake of it is not as high as it should be. So I think it's improved. I think the local authorities are sort of getting better at sort of identifying those families that are eligible, but it is still reliant on people applying for it. So I think that could improve. I think uptake of all these things would be a beneficial thing. So, you know, as I say, there are families that aren't receiving the Scottish Child Payment because they're not receiving universal credit, even though they're eligible for it. There are people who are probably eligible for the discretionary housing payments who aren't receiving them. So I think that needs to be part of it as well, is making sure that everybody who is eligible is actually receiving what they're entitled to.
Thank you for your comments. I'll hand back to Convene.
I think Ruth would like to come in. Thanks.
Thanks so much. So just following on from your question about the two-child limit and the benefit caps, so along with colleagues at the University of Oxford and London School of Economics, I led like a mixed method study looking at the impact of the two-child limit and the benefit cap. And I think that because we're talking here about evidence, and like obviously one of the kind of key things that you guys are trying to think through is how do we get the evidence on the Scottish Child Payment and the impact it will have. You know, I guess when we look at the impact of the two-child limit and the benefit cap, that's like, you know, what's the impact of the counterfactual? What's the impact when you literally take money away, and you take money away from children, you take money away from families with children, and you do that divorcing of needs and entitlement? And so what I would say, and I'd sort of encourage those interested to engage with the evidence base, is that we do have the evidence now on the impact of the two-child limit and the benefit cap. Unfortunately, these policies have been with us for some time, and what we see is just the range and the multiplicity of harms that those policies are doing. And as Marie and Dr. Sun have kind of alluded to, these will be people in Scotland that are being impacted by the policies, albeit now with the mitigation of the benefit cap. And I think what's really one of the things that's kind of been most difficult in terms of engaging with that evidence is that as kind of a researcher that works in the kind of poverty field, and as I'm sure all of you are aware, it's common when we talk to families in poverty to hear parents talking about trying to protect their children from the impact of poverty. So they'll say, oh, you know, I'll skip a meal because I want my children not to go without. But what we find at the impact to the two-child limit is that we find parents reporting that their children are trying to protect them, so they're trying to protect the parents from the impact of the poverty. So they're saying, they're reporting examples where children are saying, you know, that they're not telling their parent that they need a new pair of school's shoes because they know the money's not there. We've got evidence of people in the supermarkets with, you know, children with siblings, and they're saying, don't ask mummy for that, she doesn't have the money. And I think we've got to think about the harm that's been done to children by those policies. And again, just relating it back to the Scottish Child Payment, you know, I think when we look at the monitoring the impact, it's really important that we look at the kind of long-term impacts on children and hopefully the long-term benefits that we would expect to see, but also the value of thinking about the childhood we want. And, you know, we should be a, you know, I'm Scottish, we should be a country that wants our children to have good childhoods, and making sure that, that those children have, you know, those families have monies in their pockets to pay for essentials, to maybe pay for that football club after school. That will help ensure that children have good childhoods, and that's absolutely the bread and butter of policy making, I'd say.
Okay. Really interested to hear a bit more about that. If you've got anything else, could you maybe send it into the committee? I'm sure they'll be interested too.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite John Mason and then Bob Doris. Thanks.
Okay, thanks. I mean, just really the other side of Marie's question, so maybe I'll start with yourself, Professor Patrick, seeing you were speaking. I mean, I think we're talking about something like 54,000 low-income children who are not getting universal credit. But the other angle is that some who are not in low income, and the figure we've been given is 241,000, are in receipt of universal credit and Scottish Child Payment, but they're not in low incomes. I mean, it's obviously nice to give people money, but is that not a good use of funding?
Yes, so I think my colleague Emma Tomney may be better qualified on that, but I think what I would say is that there is this kind of question you're working through around how do you kind of maximise eligibility, how do you kind of make sure it reaches the right people, and I think as part of that, trying to make it a standalone benefit is the right direction to go in, and I think for loads of reasons, but definitely in terms of kind of broadening the take up. But I would defer to Emma on the question of, you know, who should it hit.
Yeah. Okay, Professor Tomney.
So the worry is that individuals not in poverty are receiving Scottish Child Payment.
Yes, I don't. Well, is it a worry? I don't know if it is a worry or not.
Yeah. Okay. Well, it's not a worry of mine because, you know, cash transfers to children living in low-income families is how I would think about a Scottish Child Payment. I think the point's been made before, but, you know, imagine you've got your poverty threshold, two families either side of it. So one family's just outside the poverty threshold. They're going to be living the same life as the children just inside the poverty threshold. They'll have the same level of food insecurity. Their families will be feeling the same amount of stress and trying to make to balance the budgets. So, you know, you're targeting low-income families who are living in deprivation and who can use the cash transfer. So, I think what's really important is to gather empirical evidence, isn't it? So what's the effect of the Scottish Child Payment for individuals out of work, for individuals close to that universal credit threshold? That's what you need to understand to answer your questions, really. It's an empirical question. Where is the impact greatest?
Okay, so I'll leave it to that, because I think Bob Doris is going to go into that space
and
as well.
Bob, I believe Tom would like to come in, and if you could make it brief. Sorry, Tom. I think you're on mute.
I was muted. Yeah, I just wanted to add to that question. I'm not too concerned about Scottish Child Payment going to children in sort of middle of income distribution necessarily. You know, income is not the same as need, and actually in some ways the benefit system is more responsive to needs. For example, people who are disabled or carers, they get extra benefits often as a result of that. If you just look at where they are in the income distribution, they're more in the middle rather than bottom. So, you know, lots of disabled people, they're not technically in poverty, but they've only got more income because they've got more needs and more expenses to achieve a given standard of living. And those sorts of people are getting captured by the benefit system. That's not a bad thing if you're trying to raise people's, you know, low-income people's living standards. So insofar as that's true, and the Scottish Child Payment is going to people like that who have additional needs and to look after their children, I think that's fine.
Okay, thanks very much. Before I bring you in, I believe Juliet would like to come in on this.
Thanks. Yeah, just I think as well, I'm not concerned about it either, for the reasons that have already been said, but I think just following up on that idea of needs, I think is important, because what the... So we're talking about incomes, but that doesn't reflect needs. And we know that there's been this cost of living crisis. Lots of costs have increased. That is not reflected when we're measuring poverty because it's not reflecting how people's needs have changed. We also know that there was a benefits freeze, you know, so benefits weren't uprated for years and years. They've only just been uprated, but that hasn't mitigated against the fact that they weren't uprated since 2016. So actually, the level of universal credit is not necessarily reflective of what people's actual needs are. And people who are eligible for universal credit, even if their sort of incomes are sort of ostensibly higher, aren't necessarily going to be living the high life. So, yeah. I would reiterate that.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Bob in. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I suppose it's on the universality or targeting now. It's not universal because universal credit is not universal, but it's about blanket coverage for those in receipt of universal credit, for instance. Child payment is straightforward to administer and it's impactful. I think that's clear. I was looking there, and maybe my numbers are a little bit wrong, but if we increase by another £5 a week, it may be another £90 million or so a year that would cost. If we had £90 million a year, should we leverage it all into a Scottish child payment, or would we increase Bed Start grant and Bed Start foods? Could we pay a clothing grant twice a year? Could we give a Scottish Child Payment summer supplement rather than spreading it across the year? So it's that debate about when we do target more and when we make it as universal as possible, and how should government and parliament look at that, I suppose, Professor Patrick?
Yes, I think it's always a big question, and I think when you were sort of asking for views on this earlier, there was questions around the simplicity of kind of, you know, close to universality versus universal credit versus like more targeting. And I think one of the other kind of factors that you should really keep in your mind when you're thinking about that is around stigma. So around the stigma of benefit receipts. So often when we start to target things, when we move around away from cash-based transfer, we embed and we increase the stigma. So I think that would be just another thing to be thinking about when you're trying to make those decisions. In terms of like how is the money best spent, I would just really encourage the idea that pound for pound, putting money into Scottish Child Payment, I can't imagine like a better use of funds. And I think especially recognising and valuing kind of parents' own expertise. So, you know, the idea of saying, okay, well, in the summer, we're going to maybe give you an extra supplement because we recognise that's a difficult time. You know, do we know that different households may have different needs at different times of the year? So actually recognising, we also know there's like literally, we could fill the chamber with the evidence base. We know that people living on low incomes and poverty, they're experts at budgets. They know how to manage their money incredibly well. So give them the money and the decision to kind of work out how best to budget. You know, it may be that their children have all their birthdays clustered around February. So actually that's their particular financial pressure point. I think that really recognising their expertise in budget management and giving them the resource, definitely in cash, not in vouchers, is definitely the way to go.
It's really helpful. I know we're short for time. Professor Tomini, I think, wanted to come in, then I'll move on to my next question.
Yeah. I'll just be really quick then. My reading of the international evidence, that we have a lot of evidence about the effects of cash transfers. There's no policy exactly the same as Scottish Child Payment, but if I combine all of that evidence together, cash transfers make a difference when they are expected. They're expected to continue into the long run. So when there's a one-off payment, often doesn't actually change that much within the household. So again, I think, you know, Scottish Child Payment is set up, it's there. That, in my, from the reading of the evidence, rather than doing one-off payments here or there, I put the money into Scottish Child Payment. And the only other thing to say, targeted or not targeted, it's the targeted policies that have the biggest effect as well. In my mind, it was, yeah.
Okay, that's helpful. As always, it's never straightforward. Moving on to my next question, I suppose an unintended consequence of the success, I suppose, of the Scottish Child Payment is, as universal credit tapers, the Scottish Child Payment does not taper. And we all in this Parliament and this committee want to see mums and dads, families get into not just work, but well-paid work, and hours that allows them to sustain a quality of living without relying on benefits. But there's a cliff edge created that when universal credit goes altogether, so does the Scottish Child Payment. So maybe some comments and solutions in relation to that? I'll maybe roll the two questions into one. The idea of tapering, yep, is whether that's tapering within universal credit, which I'd be a bit wary of taking money off of people when they're still on universal credit, or a roll-on of benefit and tapering once they leave. So I'll leave that hanging there. Any comments from witnesses, Professor Tominey?
Yeah, so I think it's a really important question. And in our research that we're hoping to conduct, if we're funded, that is one of the main points that we're going to try and analyse. It's an empirical question, so we don't know yet. But you're right, you know, at that point to which households lose universal credit, then there's a big change to their income. So we're going to analyse and see, does it change work incentives? But the second thing to point out is, because it's not tapered, there are actually quite strong incentives to enter work. So if you consider individuals who are out of work and they're thinking, you know, shall I take a job and earn some money, the universal credit will drop, but the Scottish Child Payment doesn't. So again, potentially there are quite strong incentives at that margin. So it's our plan to analyse it qualitatively, quantitatively, but again, it's quite data demanding, because what you want to do is understand the effect on labour market decisions across the income distribution. So again, that administrative data, linked administrative data, that would really allow us to hone in on those specific margins. So for now, you know, I would say it's an empirical question rather than giving advice about how to taper. Yeah.
Okay, are there any other comments in relation to that?
Tom Warren, I would like to come in. Thanks.
Yeah, I just wanted to sort of follow up on that. I think, yeah, the idea of sort of tapering people within universal credit rather than expanding eligibility, that's necessarily going to sort of increase the effective marginal tax rate people face if they're having even more benefit withdrawn. So that's going to sort of create a different kind of disincentive to work. Obviously, if you just taper off the end after people leave universal credit, that's going to come with additional cost. I think in all of these cases, sort of trading off, if you introduce more tapering, then there's going to be more people facing a little bit of disincentive at the margin. If they work an extra hour, they're not going to keep quite so much of their money, but it's going to be sort of spreading out that disincentive rather than at the moment where it's really concentrated people just on the edge of eligibility facing this huge drop-off. I think I worked out, if you're on minimum wage and you've got two kids, for example, and you're just on that drop-off, you've got to basically work 6.5 extra hours before you see an extra pound from work. So that's a per week. So that's a huge amount. That's a huge cliff edge. And even if, you know, in aggregate, we don't see huge effects on work incentives, and it might only be a small number of people affected, for those people, that's a really awkward situation to be in. It's going to be quite stressful, especially, you know, if people have volatile earnings or shifts or whatever, actually keeping track of that and making sure they don't accidentally lose quite a lot of money. So it's going to be creating quite significant inconvenience and stress for people who are around that, and potentially disincentivizing them from seeking promotions or seeking extra hours and progressing in their careers and so on.
I think that's very helpful. Maybe Mr. Wernham could add a little bit with a benefit run-on. So once universal credit is fully withdrawn, a tapered benefit run-on, would it still have a negative impact? And obviously there'd be a cost to that. Could there be an opportunity for the DWP and the Scottish Government to talk about, if that's in-work incentive to get someone off of universal credit, could there be a co-produced plan to have a benefit run-on that is financed by both Scottish and UK governments, I suppose? You're on mute, Tom.
Yeah, I can't. Yeah. Sorry, I was muted by somebody. I think it's interesting. I mean, it's going to be essentially just increasing the number of people who are facing this disincentive. So, yeah, you're going to have a sort of, yeah, instead of people just at the cliff edge facing an extreme disincentive, you're going to have a slightly larger number of people facing a sort of slight disincentive. I mean, it seems that's probably going to be better, though it'd be useful to have qualitative evidence. But yeah, we'll be challenging, I think, require cooperation with DWP instead of just sort of essentially piggybacking on the UC system. You're going to have people who aren't eligible for UC but are eligible for the Scottish Child Payment. So there's going to have to be cooperation and making sure you have the income data you need to identify these people. But yeah, it's always a sort of trade-off, and you know, any means-tested benefit, you're going to have to, you're going to be creating these disincentives. But I think in just tapering off is going to be probably milder than a cliff edge, which is a really extreme form of disincentive to a small subset of people.
Thank you, Kavina.
Okay, thanks very much. You'll be pleased to know that we're on to our last theme, which is cost and value for money, and I'm going to invite Ros McCullough. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener, and welcome everybody. And yes, I have the joy of looking at cost and value for money. I think I already know the answer to this question, but I'm going to go for it anyway. The Scottish Child Payment is forecast to cost 457 million, rising up to 492 million by 2028-29. And yep, I get that all the written submissions coming in said that that's money well spent, so I understand that. Given evidence we've already taken today, from especially in the first section, where that arbitrary line of poverty, which is what we're all looking at, and the fact that we really should be looking more in depth of how it's actually going to change the lives of children, maybe looking at health, maybe looking at actual outcomes, is that spend justified? And I'm happy to open that out to anybody that wants to answer that question. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, there's no spoiler alert for this question. So absolutely, I honestly couldn't imagine a better use of the funds. I think it's an absolutely excellent investment in resource. I think as we've said, and we've kind of covered at length in this session, there is still a need to kind of understand the evidence about what's going on. But getting cash to families on a low income to support them with their needs and of their children is absolutely a brilliant use of money, and it's to be commended that's where it is at the moment.
Brilliant. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in, but I would imagine the answer will be exactly the same.
Hello. Yes, it's justified completely, not least because of the long-term effects over many decades of these children's lives in future. However, it's important to remember that this was introduced in an emergency, two emergencies. One was having the greatest inequality in Europe, give or take Bulgaria, and some of the worst rates of child deprivation. And secondly, a cost of living crisis, which has resulted in this huge increase in people's expenditures, which we pretend or we don't realise just because inflation has gone down. None of that cost in living crisis has been taken away because it hasn't gone below incomes. So this was introduced in an emergency, and it is an emergency response. Long term, you do not want a society in Europe having to depend on things like this. You want a long term way out where you're not worrying about tapers and can people afford shoes? And can they do joint birthday parties for a child, or can they have one at all, or can, most large numbers of these children have no holiday. So there's a danger of congratulating too much because something dramatic has been done and far fewer children are going cold and hungry in Scotland, and not actually thinking, what kind of a society did we used to have when our children grew up in far more equal houses in the 1960s and 70s, and what kind of societies do other European countries currently have where their children are doing so much better than ours? So it's a different answer to, it's completely justified, but it is an emergency response to an emergency situation.
That's very interesting. Thank you.
Okay, I believe Juliet would like to come in. Thanks.
Thank you. I guess in addition to the sort of human cost of child poverty, which, is very difficult to measure, but we've talked about a bit. Also at Loughborough, we've also done some work looking at the cost to society of child poverty. So thinking about things like, as Danny was saying, in the longer term, things like future tax loss to the government, loss in earnings, targeted public spending for children in poverty because of the sort of additional health effects of being in poverty. And the estimate was that it was £39 billion a year for the UK. So I think in the context of that, the cost of the Scottish Child Payment is a drop in the ocean, and it's having such a measurable, sort of effect on improving children's lives that I think, you know, it's a no-brainer, really.
Okay. Thank you. And I suppose, in a way, that kind of leads me on to the sort of the next part of the question. Because it is, in effect, a payment of cash which takes over that arbitrary line, which we've all agreed. So are there alternative policies that might have a similar or greater impact for either a similar or maybe even a reduced or ended cost? But is there actually other ways that we could be doing this?
In my view, I think it is the best policy that can be put forward. I think, you know, and I think my sort of colleagues would probably agree with me. I think, and as Ruth said, the infrastructure is now there for the Scottish Child Payment. And yes, there can be modifications to it and increasing eligibility, you know, things like tapers. But I think given that infrastructure is there, then, you know, in addition to the other kind of policy, things like the Best Start grants and the free school meals, you know, in combination with that, I can't think of a better way of giving vulnerable families this sort of increase in cash.
Add to that. So, I agree and I echo what Juliet said. And I think the other thing that would just be maybe worth drawing a comparison between is a sort of Scottish Child Payment as you have currently in Scotland, where, you know, there's some sort of certainty that payment is going to continue so people can plan for the future on that basis. And if we contrast that with the kind of policies that we've seen on Social Security in terms of that sort of emergency response from Westminster, which have been sort of one-off, often flat rate payments. So if we think about those cost of living grants, if we think about the sort of temporary uplift of £20 to universal credit, these were less well targeted because a family of five would get the same as a single person, but they were also, importantly, they were embedding in security, because what we had with those policies is we had, okay, yes, you know, there's an emergency, so we're going to give you a cost of living payment, but then, you know, is it going to continue next year? You know, no, it's not. It might not, so people aren't able to plan. And I think when people are living with kind of on a low income, financial insecurity is often sort of baked into their everyday life. So where we can kind of put back in some security, and it echoes what Emma was saying about what makes a difference. What makes a difference with cash transfers is knowing, is having some certainty that infrastructure exists and that it will continue to do so.
Thank you very much indeed.
I just say we seem to have lost the Zoom link with our members online, so I very much apologise for that. But what I will say is, before we end this session, is that if anyone does have any further comments to make, then we'd be more than happy to have any written submissions from yourselves as well. So can I just say thank you so much to all our witnesses today. And next week we'll hear from a panel of stakeholders in what will be our second and final evidence session for this short inquiry as well. So this actually concludes our public business for today, and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you.